Gives me great pleasure to welcome you here tonight on a gorgeous evening. So thanks for coming for this very special Grace MacInnis lecture by Libby Davies. Before I go any further, I'd just like to acknowledge that this event is taking place on the unceded territories of the Coast Salish peoples, the territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh nations. I'd also like to just take a couple of minutes before I go on to introduce my colleague, Dr. Eleanor Stebner, who's the J.S. Woodsworth Chair, to just say a couple of things about the Institute for the Humanities, as well as the J.S. Woodsworth Chair. Then Dr. Stebner will then talk a little bit about the legacy of Grace MacInnis, and then, of course, introduce our distinguished speaker for this evening. So SFU is extremely unique in that it has a constellation of programs that are tied together under the aegis of the Department of the Humanities. These are the Institute for the Humanities, which seeks to foster a critical discussion of some of the pressing issues of the day through the prism of the humanistic tradition broadly understood, the Grace MacInnis Visiting Scholar Program, as well as the J.S. Woodsworth Chair. I'm just going to say a couple of things about the Institute and the Chair before I go on to introduce Professor Stebner. Now in its 32nd year, the Institute for the Humanities at SFU seeks to accomplish three basic objectives: to stimulate student interest and faculty research in demonstrating the irreducibility of humanistic perspectives in understanding some of the most pressing social, economic, political, environmental issues we presently face, and above all, to engage the many publics beyond the academy in the city, the province, the country, and indeed the wider world. I think in this respect, the Institute is perfectly placed to play a key role in making SFU into a student-centered, research-driven, and community-engaged university. Our program for 2015 to 2016, particularly I'm thinking about the fall program, reflects that we are in the midst of what could be considered one of the most important general federal elections since Confederation. The program's title, which is State of Emergency, is taken from a TEDx talk given by one of our speakers this fall, Professor Pam Palmiter, Chair of Indigenous Governance at Ryerson University. Coming just prior to Justice Murray Sinclair's release of the TRC report, Dr. Palmiter drew attention to the fact that, particularly from an Indigenous perspective, Canada is in the midst of a state of emergency. The most obvious example of this is the government's stubborn reluctance to mount an inquiry into Canada's national disgrace, the hundreds of missing and murdered Aboriginal women over the past decades. In 1940, Walter Benjamin wrote in direct response to Hitler's crown jurist, the theorist of the state of exception, Carl Schmitt, quote, "The tradition of the oppressed teaches us that the state of emergency in which we live is not the exception, but the rule. We must attain to a conception of history that is in keeping with this insight," end quote. There could scarcely be a more poignant assessment of the history of settler colonialism and its effects, particularly on First Nations, not least because such an ongoing state of emergency was brought about in the name of the historical progress that Walter Benjamin speaks about in that important text on the philosophy of history. We see such an ongoing state of emergency in the current economic crisis, the dramatic drop in the value of the Canadian dollar with the falling price of oil, the ongoing feud between the government and the Supreme Court, the new security legislation that, according to claims made by the BCCLA, has empowered the government to illegally spy on peaceful dissidents and NGOs such as Tides Canada and the Dogwood Initiative, the bombing campaign of questionable legality in Syria, the punitive use of the Canadian Revenue Agency to crack down on the government's critics, and the stifling of the scientists whose findings constitute what Al Gore once referred to as inconvenient truths that might undermine the government's plan to transform Canada into a so-called energy superpower. In this, we logically follow up on last year's program, Democracy and Dissent, which drew attention to the fact that as dissent has become increasingly criminalized and Canadian parliamentary democracy is in free fall. Last summer, we co-hosted a conference devoted to exploring the ideas of the Frankfurt School, the highlight of which was a keynote by the distinguished U.S. intellectual historian Martin Jay of UC Berkeley, as well as the Canadian Society for Continental Philosophy's annual meeting, which featured, among other wonderful keynotes, Professor Howard Cagle speaking about the capacity to resist. Each addressed, in its own way, the importance of critical perspectives of art and philosophy in genuine democracies. This year we have Alex Neave, the Secretary General of Amnesty International Canada, who will speak about the many grave implications of C-51 for human rights. Donald Gutstein will speak about his book on Harperism, which documents the way in which right-wing think tanks, such as the Fraser Institute and the National Citizens Coalition, once headed by Prime Minister Harper, have set about transforming the political culture of this country in a way that has enabled the Conservative Party's historic majority government. Meanwhile, their more left-leaning counterparts, such as the CCPA, the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives, have been subjected to punitive audits by the CRA, Canadian Revenue Agency. Professor Palmiter will be speaking on Taking Back Canada on September 24th. Shortly thereafter, leading Russian dissident Boris Kagarlitsky will speak to the situation in Russia and its relationship to the Ukraine. The Gandhi Memorial Lecture will be presented by Jennifer Simons, a very, very good friend of the Institute and the Simons Chair. The Woodsworth Chair. She'll be speaking on October 1st. The former chair of the ALR, the Agricultural Land Reserve Commission, Richard Bullock, who was dismissed from his post, according to some, because he disagreed with the BC government about opening up the ALR for development at a time of climate change and worries about food security, will be speaking in the middle of October. We also have the award-winning journalist and filmmaker Michael Harris, author of Party of One, Stephen Harper and the Unmaking of Canada, speaking on the Rubicon election of 2015 on October 5th. At the end of October, Roxanne Dunbar-Ortiz will be speaking about her myth-busting, prize-winning book, An Indigenous People's History of the United States, in which we will certainly hear many disturbing echoes of our own history. As a contribution to the 50th anniversary celebrations at SFU this year, we're hosting a major conference on the legacy of Ernst Becker, the Pulitzer Prize-winning author who taught at SFU for several years and whose theory of terror management remains extremely influential. Relatedly, we'll be hosting a panel on the politics of fear in the context of the Canadian election, which is a very critical issue. We'll also be co-hosting with Gen Y and Creative Publics at the Fox Theatre in Vancouver panel discussion and party, really, on how best to engage young voters in this country. In all, our program is going to be without a doubt, our most important and most exciting in our history. It is one that will no doubt help confirm SFU as the most engaged university in the country. The J.S. Woodsworth Endowment, I'm going to turn to talk just a couple of minutes about the J.S. Woodsworth Endowment and Chair, mandates a full-time teaching position in the Department of Humanities and provides funding for other positions and community activities where possible in order to recognize the signal contributions of J.S. Woodsworth to the history of this country. As a member of Parliament, a clergyman, and a social reformer, Woodsworth was a social activist whose contributions to issues of social justice has left a legacy that strongly influenced Canadian political traditions based on the ideas of equity, social obligation, and civic responsibility. The holder of the Woodsworth Chair combines teaching and research with active engagement in issues concerning the wider community, local and national, as well as international. The holder of the Woodsworth Chair works closely with the director of the Institute, that's me, and other faculty to further public understanding of the J.S. Woodsworth Endowment mandate. Very delighted to say that past holders of the J.S. Woodsworth Chair include Dr. Robert Menzies of Sociology and Anthropology at SFU, Dr. Sandra Joie, who's emerita in the Department of English, Mr. Ed Broadbent, the former leader of the NDP, and Dr. Alan Whitehorn, as well as a distinguished social philosopher, Nancy Fraser. The current J.S. Woodsworth Chair, who I'm now delighted to introduce is Dr. Eleanor Stebner, who's been at SFU as the Woodsworth Chair since 2005. She taught previously at the University of Winnipeg and in Chicago. Her PhD is from Northwestern University. And I should also mention that she holds another chair. She's kind of straddling two chairs, and that other chair is the chair of my department, the Department of Humanities. So please join me now in welcoming Dr. Eleanor Stebner.
Welcome to all of you. Thank you for coming out to a really special event. The Institute is delighted to recognize decades of public service by Miss Libby Davies. In our downtown East Side, in our East Vancouver neighborhood, in the entire civic community, local, national, international levels. Her desire has been to create a better world, a world that is caring, a world that is more just, a world that is not only inclusive, but also appreciative of everyone. And I know that everything she does and has done has just tired me out, and I know that I'm not the only one who stands in awe of you. How in the world has she had the energy and the determination to keep at it for so many decades? Is that a rhetorical question? So the award we're going to give her tonight is the Grace MacInnis Award. This was established in 1993, but it's not an annual event. I want you to know that. The award is reserved for women who have in their own ways followed the legacy of Grace MacInnis. Now MacInnis was born 120 years ago in that great city of Winnipeg. Oldest child of J.S. and Lucy Woodsworth. She was brought up in the Protestant social gospel environment of the day, which was a movement that worked to radicalize Christianity into action for political, social, and economic justice. And MacInnis went on to become, along with many others, one of the founders of the Cooperative Commonwealth Federation, as well as her father and her soon-to-be husband, that formed in 1932. And she labored for years in the grassroots of the CCF as a caucus secretary, public speaker, campaigner for various electoral candidates. And then in 1941, she herself was elected a member of the BC Legislature, BC Assembly. And after the New Democratic Party was born from the roots of the CCF, MacInnis was elected a Member of Parliament for Vancouver Kingsway. She became the first BC woman MP to travel to Ottawa, and she held that role for almost 10 years. Now, in her political work, MacInnis was a voice for the rights of women, for their access to abortion, for income for stay-at-home mothers, for daycare for working mothers. She advocated for the rights of Japanese Canadians, immigrants, and the poor. She stressed the need for adequate housing, consumer protection. She never lost the importance of her roots in Vancouver, Kingsway, and the importance of local neighborhoods, but she was also active in the international labor movements. Now, given this very brief overview of Grace MacInnis, it is clear that Libby Davies has embodied and extended her ideals and her vision, and we're very thankful for that. So on behalf of all of us, thank you, Ms. Davies, for accepting this award, for being with us here tonight, and for speaking to us about how grassroots activism can actually maybe, possibly, miraculously be translated into the parliamentary context. Thank you and welcome.
Well, thank you very much, Eleanor, for that great introduction and for sharing a little bit of history about Grace MacInnis. And the first thing I want to do is actually introduce to you Ellen Woodsworth, who is the great niece of J.S. Woodsworth. Ellen, stand up. And of course, Ellen Woodsworth, in her own right, is a great activist in Vancouver and a former city councillor. And I'm just so happy that she's here tonight, because Ellen and I go way, way back. So some of the things I'm going to talk about, she knows only too well, and she was a part of it. So I feel very honored to be here tonight. And I want to thank you for coming, because it is a beautiful evening. And I could say, you should all be out door knocking and canvassing, but it's okay. I'm happy that you're here at this lecture. But I do want to say that I'm not by any means a formal lecturer. I have spoken at high schools and even kindergartens and primary schools and universities too, but I'm not a lecturer. So if you came expecting that, I'm afraid I'm going to really disappoint you. I was scrambling together a few notes before I got here in my office this afternoon. I'm surrounded by packing boxes because I'm putting together kind of an archive of my work, not only as an MP, but also as a city councillor, and before that, as an organizer in the Downtown East Side. So I've been going through all of this material that's like 40 years old, and it's kind of a bit overwhelming. I keep sort of discovering things that I've forgotten, so I'm surrounded by the packing boxes. Oh, by the way, Eleanor or somebody, can you give me a warning when I'm... How long am I meant to speak, by the way?
As long as you want.
Oh, no, don't say that. Hey, I'm used to filibustering in Parliament, you know. Don't say that. I mean, when you think, you know, I need to start wrapping up, like, wave your arms or do something. Okay, please do that, because I'll lose track of time. But I wanted to begin by saying something about Grace MacInnis, because that's why I'm here, because for this lecture. And I did not know Grace MacInnis personally, but I can say that I had a pivotal moment in my early formation that was very important to me. I didn't know it then, but like in many things in life, you don't know it at the time, you only know it later when you come back and realize that it was a lesson learned. And when I first started in the Downtown East Side in 1972, I was 19, this was just a year before the Downtown East Side Residents Association started, I was working in a low-cost food store, and then the next year we came back and we started a newspaper called the Downtown East, and we used to deliver it door to door in every hotel and rooming house. And when I look at those old papers now, which are all yellowed and torn, it was a crazy paper. But it was a great, you know, it was a great tool, because we used it as an organizing tool. And the Downtown East Side Residents Association was just beginning to form. And you have to think that this community, just a few blocks from here, that we call the Downtown East Side, was still called Skid Road. And it was really a forbidden, unknown area in Vancouver. It was not considered a neighborhood. It was considered a place where alcoholics, drunks, down and outs, you know, hung out in the rooming houses when they came into town from the logging camps and the mining locations and from fishing and so on. So it was kind of like a non-entity, and I got involved there sort of by accident. It was a summer project. It was called Opportunities for Youth, actually. And so as DIRA began with this radical idea that people who lived in a neighborhood had the right to be heard and had the right to have a voice and to be organized, we started organizing, and it was kind of like a union. And the person who was very much an influence on my life, politically and otherwise, my partner, Bruce Erickson, he lived in the neighborhood, and it was very much a vision, an idea of working with people on their rights and having people themselves speak out for their own rights and their own experience. And this is something, you know, that sounds very familiar and easy, but back then, unbelievably, it was considered to be somehow radical, and we were going up against all of the norms and all of the traditions and power structures in Vancouver. So DIRA itself, as a grassroots organization, has had an incredible influence on the politics of Vancouver, civically. And I'm not going to go into that because that would be another story. But the point I want to jump off at is that when we were starting at DIRA, our first office was in the First United Church at Hastings and Gore. And then we got a big federal grant, which we had to fight tooth and nail for and go to the media and embarrass the government to give us. And we finally got it. And we moved to East Cordova at Princess Street. And one day, a young guy walked in called Takio Yamashiro. And he told us with his co-worker, Jun Hamada, that they were working with elderly Japanese seniors who were returning to the neighborhood that they had been evicted from during the war, Powell Street, what was called Japantown. And so we began to work with what became known as the Tonarigumi, which was a drop-in center for elderly, what they call Issei, which is the first generation of Japanese Canadians. And it was the connection with the Tonarigumi, who were literally, first of all, they had their office in the DIRA office, and then they moved into a space just around the corner on East Hastings Street and Princess, and they stayed there for many years. And I used to go to their events, and it was mostly elderly Japanese Canadians. And what I remember is meeting Grace MacInnis. And she was an absolute hero to them, because they remembered that during the war, she spoke out. She spoke out against the internment of Japanese Canadians. She spoke out against the segregation. She spoke out against their property, the fishing boats and their stores and their businesses being stolen. And so that's where I first heard about Grace MacInnis. And I phoned today Takio Yamashiro, who's now 72. And you know, this is 40 years ago. And I phoned him up and said, "Hi, Takio, it's Libby. How are you doing?" He goes, "Oh, hi, Libby, how are you doing?" It's like 40 years had just, you know, disappeared. And I said, "You know, when did Grace MacInnis come to the Tonarigumi? Because I have this memory of meeting her." And so he went back, this was like at 3:30 this afternoon, he went back and looked at some of his old photo albums, and sure enough, they had held a dinner in her honor. This was after she had been a member of parliament. She left in 1975, and they did a dinner in her honor to remember this incredible work that she had done. And at the time, it had an impact on me, because I've always remembered meeting this woman ever so briefly, never knowing, never dreaming that I myself would become a member of parliament 20 years later. So, you know, history has a way of bringing us together. And she was a very remarkable woman. The topic today is very loosely kind of grassroots politics in parliament, whatever that means. I'll try and explain it. I do want to say, though, that I never planned to be elected. For some people, it is definitely kind of a career thing, and they plot it out, and they get involved in the party, and they work their way up and do this and that. And for me, it was never like that. It was really more a sort of an accident. And so my experience in electoral politics really came about because of my involvement as an activist in the Downtown East Side. And when I look back on those early years from 1972 to about 1982, and there are many amazing stories, it was actually a pretty crazy decade, and we were sort of fighting on all fronts. We were fighting like life and death issues, and hearing about some of the issues that Grace MacInnis worked on, you know, ironically, it's still some of the stuff that, of course, we're working on today. So we make progress, but we also meet obstacles, and we end up working on the same things. But in those early years, we were working on issues like trying to force city council to enforce their own fire bylaws. Like, people were dying in fires every year because these old rooming houses were just like chimney stacks. They have an open stairwell. You've got single rooms. You've got illegal wires going up into the light bulb. You know, no hot, no cooking, deplorable conditions. And we were often losing five or seven people or more a year in fires from people who, you know, may have not put out their cigarette. It was just like a chimney. And so I learned back then a very early lesson at DERA, and that is that part of organizing and learning about your rights is actually understanding what the law is and learning that there are laws that, you know, they sit on the books, but if they're not being implemented and they're not being used, then they're useless. And so our mission and our campaign became to enforce those laws. It was very straightforward. The slum landlords threatened to close down the rooming houses. Oh, we're not making any money. We're going to close them down. We're going to throw these people out. Well, then we realized that all of the beer parlors, of which there are many, were all what is called Class A beer parlors. And the old Class A liquor license, you have to have rooms attached. Aha. Once we figured that out, we knew that they couldn't close down because they didn't want to lose the beer parlor, because that's where they made all the money. So we had many campaigns to enforce the fire bylaws, the standards of maintenance bylaws, to try and upgrade and maintain very basic living standards. So these were very basic issues. And I can tell you, nobody trained us. It was totally, you know, by the seat of your pants. We alienated a lot of people, but we also had a lot of allies, and not just in the downtown east side. We had periods where we were funded by the city. We got some money to hire organizers, but most of the time we kind of shared what was called then unemployment insurance, and we kind of like share a wage. But we had battles with City Hall, who didn't want to fund us because we were seen to be too political. So it was a very interesting decade, and the only reason I want to kind of put it out there is because for me, I think that's where my politics came from. It didn't come from the NDP per se. It really came out of working in the community and learning how to be an organizer and understanding what it meant to build those relationships and to be allies with people and sometimes have enemies too. And so then when I became a city councillor, which was again, not something that was really planned. For those who remembers Harry Rankin, an old lefty lawyer and city councillor, I remember sitting in Harry Rankin's living room on Hull Street as in 1976, and with Cope, and he pointed his finger at me and said, "You're going to run." And I kind of looked around and, you know, who's he talking? Oh, it's me. So that's actually how I ended up running for city council, because I was ordered to do it by Harry Rankin. And I didn't dare say no. And I was terrified. I remember being on my first civic panel with old Jack Webster, with George Pewell, who was an old kind of curmudgeon on the right. And, you know, I was 23. And I was like pretty gutsy, but you know, like I had no training, and it was pretty terrifying to just kind of get out there and do your thing. But somehow when you're young, you do it, right? You don't know what the rules are, and so you just go ahead and do it. So I certainly learned a lot, both in the downtown east side and being on city council, where it's a very city council, and Ellen will certainly know this and bear this out. The political experience of a city councillor is very hands-on. It's a much more egalitarian process than, say, compared to the legislature or parliament. It's much more, you know, you're there, everybody has a voice, you can get up and speak, there aren't so many rules. And so I learned a lot as a city councillor. And I can tell you that what really always fascinated me is the connection between social movement politics and electoral politics. Because as I became more involved in electoral politics, I was still very much connected to grassroots politics and community politics and social movements. And yet I could see the big disconnect. And I guess the thing that's always concerned me is that it's so easy for people to become cynical and to be turned off politics. And we get fed this message every day, mostly by the media, by the way, who I think, by and large, have a vested interest in ensuring that average people don't vote. I mean, we look at what Stephen Harper did on voter suppression, you know, similar to what they did in the United States, the so-called Fair Elections Act, which has been, you know, we're going to experience it this first election now in 2015. But I've always been concerned that there's been sort of an undercurrent of disempowering people. And of course, the poorer you are, the more marginalized you are, the more those messages, because they play into your fear and to your cynicism that nobody out there is really doing anything or cares about you. If you're rich, if you're wealthy, you know your class interest. You don't even think about voting. You know, when I was running civically, Bruce and I used to top the polls in East Vancouver, every bloody poll. And people go, yay, you know, you're getting elected. Well, of course, the voter turnout was only, you know, 30%. In the southwest corner of Vancouver, the voter turnout was 70, 80%. And when that particular poll or polls went to vote, you know, George Puhle was topping those polls, and he was getting 3,000 votes when we were getting 300. I mean, that's another outcome of the at-large system, but it led me to understand that even the notion of voting, which should be a basic democratic understanding and principle, is something that people become very alienated from. And it's partly their own experience that they are marginalized and feel unrepresented, but I think it's also a system of power and of democratic practice that and the media that contributes to that, that seeks to silence people and to say, yeah, you know, like, what's the point? They're all the same. If I've heard that once, I've heard it 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times, that all politicians are the same, it's all rotten. And of course, there are people who are rotten. There are things that are thoroughly and fundamentally wrong. But if we walk away from it, all we're doing is giving more power to the people who understand how to use their power and do it without blinking. We just give them more voice. So I was always very taken with this notion of what is the connection or disconnection between social movement politics and electoral politics, because social movement politics is very alive in this country. I mean, I've watched it over 40 years. You know, whether it's feminism, whether it's the anti-racism, or the LGBT, or whatever it is, environmentalism. I mean, that kind of politics is growing, and young people are engaged. But somehow to make the connection back to political parties and the electoral process is for some people is a struggle. And I actually understand it, because it's not that political parties or the electoral system is blameless. You know, most political parties, in fact, all political parties, including the NDP, what do they want to do? They want to win. I mean, we're seeing that now, right? You put all of your effort into an election campaign. So I think the challenge for us in that kind of space in the middle is about figuring out how we use our influence, our voice, our experience in the electoral arena, and how we try and make those connections and see it as us, not as them. And so that, as I say, that's something that's really interested me over the years. As you know, or maybe you don't, but I was elected in 1997, so 18 years ago. And when I got elected, there was a crisis beginning to unfold in the downtown east side, and that is that people were dying of drug overdoses at an alarming rate. When I first started working in the neighborhood, nobody was dying of overdoses. I mean, if it was very, very rare, but not hundreds or even thousands of people over the years. And so when I was elected in, I think it was June the 2nd of 1997, one of the first events I went to was an event in Oppenheimer Park, and it was called 1,000 Crosses. And it was organized by the Portland Hotel and others. And I remember walking from Main and Hastings up Hastings Street and then turning left and going into Oppenheimer Park, which is a very small park. And a park, by the way, which has its own history, it used to be called the Powell Street Grounds, and it was one of the main organizing venues during the 30s for unemployed workers and the beginning of the On to Ottawa trek. And I have a great book of the first woman city councilor, while we're talking about historic women, Helena Gutteridge, who was the first woman city councilor elected in Vancouver in 1936. She was CCF, and she was also a labor organizer for the Labor Council. And there's a great picture of her with her black hat, looking very severe, standing on literally on a soapbox in the Powell Street grounds, talking to the unemployed. So Oppenheimer Park itself is a very historic place. And I remember walking down the street, and there were literally 1,000 wooden crosses that had been put up in the park. And each cross signified the death of someone who had needlessly died from an overdose because the drugs that they were taking for whatever reason, self-medication, whatever it was, addiction issues, were illegal. And, you know, people don't know what they're buying. They don't know what they're taking necessarily. There are stuff that comes in that's really bad. And people were dying every day. And so I was a new MP. That was June. I went to Ottawa in September. The first day of Parliament, something called the Speech from the Throne. I had no idea what that was. We all gathered in the House of Commons, this huge room with stained glass windows, a very beautiful place. And they said, okay, now you have to walk down the hallway to the Senate, where you hear the Speech from the Throne. Okay. So I followed everybody out, all 300 of us. We trot down the hall. And as we're walking down the hall, I look at the guy next to me and I think, holy shit, that's Alan Rock, the Minister of Health. So I said, Mr. Rock, I'm Libby Davies. I'm a new MP. And I was like, I'm a new MP. I'm from Vancouver. Did you know we have a lot of people dying of overdoses, and you're the Minister of Health, and do you know about this? And, you know, we should do something about this. Can I come and meet you? And he goes, oh, yeah, of course. Delighted to meet you. Oh, I thought, this is amazing. I meet the Minister of Health, and he says he wants to meet me. So thank you, Mr. Rock. So I went away feeling pretty pleased with myself. First day, okay, did something, got something going. So I followed up. We wrote emails. We sent a few letters. Phoned his office. Oh, yes, well, you know, the minister's busy, this and that. And this went on for, like, I don't know, probably 2 months. And I thought, well, you know, this is weird. He said he'd meet me. Like, what's the matter with the guy? So I thought, well, what would I do? You know, here I'm an MP. I don't really understand how it works in this place. So what should I do? So I thought, well, okay, I know what I would do if I was still in the downtown east side. So I went down to his office. I sat in his office very politely. And I said to the receptionist, I'm Libby Davies. I've sent you emails. I've sent you letters. I've phoned you. I've asked for a meeting with the minister, and I haven't had a reply. So I'm not leaving until I get an appointment. And by the way, I have all the media outside, which I did not. I actually had one reporter from the Vancouver Sun, God bless him, who did a very good story. And so they kind of looked at me, and I was very polite. And I've learned that when you're being confrontational, be polite, okay? And smile. And so I sat there for a while, and finally they said, well, Ms. Davies, we'd be happy to give you an appointment in, you know, such and such a date. I said, great, I didn't expect it today, 2 weeks from now is fine. So that's how I got my meeting with Alan Rock. And I started talking to him about what was happening in the Downtown East Side. And he was interested, he didn't know about it. He had been the Minister of Justice, and so he had a very kind of justice lens on the issue. And the big thing then was to move it from a criminal justice issue where you criminalize drug users to a health issue. That was the big thing to move. And so I've been reading over some of my old letters to Alan Rock and all the other ministers that followed him as things heated up and, you know, Insight was getting ready to get going and we're still waiting for Health Canada. And I'm reading these letters, and some of them are pretty funny, actually. They're very intense. So I was beginning to learn what my role was, and part of my role was bringing that activism into Parliament. And what I learned is that the better connection that I had with people in the community, the better I understood what I needed to do. And this was a very important lesson in Parliament because it's a long way away. And I have to confess, when I first got there as an MP, I actually did not know what to do. No one tells you. So you're an MP. Okay, so what? Do what? You're in a party. You're in a caucus. There's all these rules. It's all hierarchical. You're told when to speak. How do you do what you think you're meant to do, what you believed you were meant to do? And I really struggled with that. I have to say that Sven Robinson helped me a lot. He had been an MP since, I think, 1979. So I talked to Sven a lot about, you know, how you do stuff. And I figured out that what had to drive me, what was going on here. And as long as I could always keep that in my head and I could keep those connections, then I was always moving forward. Because I learned, and this is what happens in politics, unfortunately, I guess this is the bad side, is that it's very easy to kind of get sucked in. Like, Ottawa is a very weird place. It's a beautiful city, but Parliament Hill is a very weird place. It's its own little world, its own little bubble, and it's all about, you know, who knows who and all the politics of what's going on. And to keep that focus of why you are there and who you represent and what it is you need to do, you may have that in your, you know, in your brain, but how to actually implement it is something you actually have to learn. And so I began to learn that, and I began to realize that in some ways, and at that point the NDP caucus was quite small. It was Alexa McDonough was the leader. There was 21 of us, and that was a breakthrough because the NDP caucus had gone down to 9 people, so they'd lost party status, so we were kind of rebuilding. And I think I was very fortunate that they kind of left me alone. You know, I was from the West Coast, and they always look at us BCers as kind of, well, you know, those people wear Birkenstocks and do yoga and smoke a lot of pot and whatever. So I was lucky that I was kind of left alone a bit. And I realized that I just had to get on and do what I believe needed to be done. And the reason I had decided to run, I should tell you, was because of housing. I was so angry that Paul Martin had dismantled the national housing programs that we'd had in 1995. I mean, he literally dealt with the deficit on the backs of poor people. You know, he's now lauded as this great finance minister who eliminated the deficit. Well, he did that by slashing the social transfers, the health transfers, and he cut out Canada's housing programs. And I had been a city councillor who had seen the incredible value of those housing programs here in Vancouver, the co-ops that were built, the social housing that was built when I was on city council using city land, long-term leases. It was federal mortgages. And that all came to a crashing halt. And, you know, when I started working in the Downtown East Side, there wasn't homelessness. You didn't see it. People were poor. They still had, you know, maybe enough money to go to the Ovaltine Cafe and buy a cup of coffee every once in a while. Wasn't like now where people are literally destitute because welfare rates have been frozen and housing hasn't kept pace and we've seen the gentrification. These are still huge issues today. And so going to Ottawa on the issue of housing, that's why I decided to run. And I decided that I wanted to do a national tour across the country on housing. And I have to tell you, I was a little bit arrogant. You know, I was from the east side. I figured I knew it all. Like, who could teach me? I knew a lot about housing. I'd worked in the downtown east side for a decade. I'd been in every rooming house and every filthy place. And, you know, I knew it all. Wow, when I went across the country and I went up north and I went into small remote communities and I saw Aboriginal people living in housing that had been built by CMHC, that you could see the spaces between the planks and the wall, and they had no plumbing and no water, no electricity. It was Gold River, northern Manitoba. I was like stunned. And then at that time, the homelessness crisis in Toronto, it was called there was the Toronto Disaster Relief Committee, and they called it the unnatural disaster of homelessness, of people dying in the streets. And so I went across the country, produced a report, and became part of a big movement to pressure the then Liberal government, who would never admit, by the way, never would they admit the catastrophe of their decision to eliminate housing. But what they did do, and I'll give Claudette Bradshaw credit for this, they appointed her as a homelessness minister, and they did start providing money for homeless for shelters. That was sort of the only way they could kind of justify it and kind of get back in. And so I hope I was able to contribute to that. So that's what I did, one of the first things I did in 1998, and then again in 2001. Some lessons learned that I want to share with you. I'm in a party, the NDP. You know, for other people, it's another party. I've learned about there's a role inside the party and outside the party. Like a lot of people, of course, they wouldn't see what goes on inside. And I learned very quickly. Thank you. I learned very quickly that the politics inside is in some ways more important than what goes on outside. And what influence you bear internally and how you use that influence is critically important. Now, this is a facet of politics that most people don't see because, of course, it's all secret. Caucus meetings are in camera. They have to be. And I do want to say I'm a team player. I always have been. I'm not a maverick. I'm not a loner. Some people may see me like that, but I'm actually a team player, and I feel better when I'm in a strong team. And so I learned how to navigate that. So the internal caucus and party politics, and it's very hard. There are, I'm sure Ellen has faced this too. There are instances where you don't agree with what's going on. And you have to say to yourself, what do I do? Do I speak out? Do I run the risk of doing damage to the party, to my colleagues? What do I do internally? And so, you know, I could speak on many different issues where I've had that experience. And it's probably actually the hardest part of politics that I've learned, is having this activism, where in activism, you can go for it all, right? You don't have to, if you don't want to compromise, you don't have to. You can just say, you know, this is 100% who we are and what we stand for, and we're not going to give in on it, and we're just going to keep going for it. Well, if you're in a political party, and you're in a caucus, and you're in a political environment, there are compromises. There are different things that evolve, and you have to learn how to live with that, or you have to get out. And some people could decide that it's not for them and decide that's not the role they want to play. I decided it was a role that I wanted to play and that I felt like I could be a voice both externally but also internally within the party. So just to give you some examples, I did learn how to speak out. One of the more interesting things I did was, I don't know if you remember when the weapons of mass destruction was happening, in about 2002, 2003, and if you remember, Bush was, I mean, they were just whipping up the frenzy about the weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. And so Steve Staples, who used to be a great activist here and then went to Ottawa, he came up with this great idea of doing a citizens' weapons inspection in the U.S. Like, we're the greatest weapons of mass destruction. Well, they're just south of us. So we organized this little team, and I can't believe that we did this, but we hired a little airplane, and we flew over Bangor, Washington, where all the nuclear subs are, and the cruise missiles, really low. Like, they would shoot us down today, I know. And we actually had clearance to go on the base. I don't know how we did that. We got clearance to go on the Pacific Command base. But as we were driving down the I-5 to Seattle, and Bangor is just south of Seattle, it's a big naval base, they revoked our presence there and said we couldn't go on the base. So we took this little airplane and we did this inspection for weapons, you see. And we had little blue hats on like the UN inspectors do. And we got a huge amount of media, which was mostly terrible, because people were really angry. Like, we had touched a nerve. And that's where I learned a very important lesson, that when you're doing something very, very controversial and it's kind of pretty in your face, like, you actually have to be very low-key about it. And so when we showed up at the base, and, you know, they're all the uniforms and the higher-ups are all standing there, I think they were expecting us to climb the fence and, you know, do a whole bunch of stuff. And so I was a spokesperson. I was the only MP. So I put on my best smile and said, you know, we're here to do a weapons inspection. Could we come in, please? And they kind of looked at us like we were crazy, and we were very polite. I mean, we knew they were going to say no. But we made our point. And we did it twice after that. We went to two places in Washington, and we did the same thing. And again, it was very controversial. So part of your role is working within the party, but part of your role is also using your position as an elected member to work with people and to get that message out. And you have to be careful about that. Like, you can get mixed up in crazy stuff, you know, and you find out that you've been very, you know, you might have been used, or you're very discredited. So you have to be smart about it. And because I knew that I was working with people that I trusted, I felt like I could use my voice and credibility. And I was very fortunate that the leader, Jack Layton at the time, he had just become leader, and I told him I was going to do this. And I was like, oh, God, he's gonna tell me I can't do it. And he was wonderful. I remember him saying to me, God, I wish I could go. I mean, he'd just become leader of the NDP, and he knew he couldn't do it. But he was okay for me to go out and do it. So being part of the caucus but keeping those connections in the community is a very important part of what I've learned in terms of grassroots politics in Parliament. Building relationships, another thing. Now, this is something you already all know in whatever work you do. It's the relationships that you build. And what I learned in politics is that if you're pretty honest and straightforward with people, even if they don't agree with you, they will trust you. And they will give you space to work on stuff. And when I first got elected and was working on the drug issue, it was very controversial. You know, up till then, you spoke about the politics of fear. You're going to have a session on it. You know, the politics of fear is around law and order, right? Like, drug dealers in your school. And, of course, the Harperites excel at this. And so it's a very traditional response for politicians to say, oh, we need more cops. We need more law and order. We need more. And to go against that, I mean, it's not so difficult now, but back then it was not very popular. And I had people in my own group, like campaign, you know, who had worked on my campaign saying, Libby, you will never get reelected. Like, you, if you're going out on this stuff, you're not going to get reelected. And I actually did think about that. And I decided that if that was to be, that was to be. But I think that even when it was controversial and there were people yelling at me and writing nasty emails that, you know, all I was wanting to do was give out free heroin to people and blah, 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 the relationships you built with people actually gave you some space to do that. And again, working in alliance with groups, and one in particular that I want to mention, VANDU, the Vancouver Area Network of Drug Users, which was a new organization, that was a very pivotal moment for me in terms of hearing directly from drug users who were my constituents about what their experience was. And hearing that experience gives you the sort of the fortitude to go into those other arenas and to, I guess, speak truth to power, you know, and say, this is what it's about. And so having some space to do that was very important. The role within the party and building support, just want to say a word on that, and again, use an example. One of the issues I've worked on over the years, and it was referenced earlier, the missing and murdered women, my first interaction with this issue was, I don't remember the year, but it was maybe early 1990s. Margaret Mitchell was still the MP, so it would have been before 93 then. And a woman's body had been found in a dumpster on Dundas Street. I forget the cross street. And we gathered at that dumpster, and we marched down to the Carnegie Center, and there was a smudge ceremony. She was an Aboriginal woman from Seashelt. And her family came down, and it was a very, very, it was the first time in the community that there was a sort of a public acknowledgement that sex workers were going missing and were probably being murdered. It had been very isolated, but it was the time that people were beginning, in fact, I think it was even in the 80s, I have to go back and look, but it was very early on, and we began calling for a police investigation of a serial murderer, and the police would dismiss it. And so that issue, you know, how far back it goes, is something that has, I've been very driven by it because it's such a tragedy. You know, if it was any other group of women, if it was nurses or students, who, you know, if six students had gone missing from UBC or SFU, like, there'd be an outcry. But because they were sex workers, because they were Aboriginal, it was like they didn't exist. They were like, they were missing people, you know. And when I started working on that issue, within the NDP, it was very controversial, and people didn't really want to deal with it. It's not exactly your mainstream issue, you know. So when I was sort of talking about sex worker rights and the need to decriminalize sex work and to strike down the laws that we have, it wasn't very popular. And again, it was a lesson of how to work internally to bring the, you know, to not necessarily fight the party, but to find ways to bring it forward. And we actually did that as recently as the last convention in, I think it was 2013, where we drafted a resolution and we put it to the floor, and we learned that it was going to be defeated because there were going to be some, it's a controversial issue. There are some folks who don't support decriminalization, and I recognize that it's a controversial issue. So we faced the possibility of it being defeated. And so what we decided to do was withdraw the resolution and refer it to what's called the Federal Council, which is the governing body of the NDP in between conventions. So we kind of redrafted the resolution, took into account some of the concerns that had been made, and we took it back to the Federal Council, where it was passed unanimously because we talked to people, we worked with our Aboriginal Commission, we worked to our Women's Commission, we talked to our Justice Critic, and we crafted the language. And so I use that as an example that, you know, we all have different roles. Like, I'm a believer of rallying on the street, speaking, you know, large demonstrations. I mean, the huge demonstrations here in Vancouver against the war in Iraq, they were pivotal in convincing Jean Chrétien to not get Canada involved in that war. There was, you know, 100,000 people a month. So that all has a role to play. But there's these other elements too, and unless you have it all together, unless you're working at every level, you aren't necessarily going to be successful. Another lesson learned, how to use the rules. If you're going to be a successful parliamentarian and you want to get your grassroots issues or your issues that are controversial, you have to learn how to use the rules. I've I'm still learning. I mean, I'm going, but I'm still learning how to do that. As recently as last December, we learned about the situation of the thalidomide survivors, of which there's only 100 or so in Canada. These are people who whose mother took the thalidomide drug and suffered terrible deformities and terrible health conditions. And they had been trying to get the Minister of Health to provide compensation, and the Minister of Health had not even replied to them. So it came to my attention. I was the health critic for the NDP, and it could have gone two ways on it. We could have just blasted the government and made it, you know, a big political issue. And I decided that we needed to try and find a way to get it through Parliament in a motion unanimously. So the first thing I had to do was sort of set the stage within my own party to get us to agree to bring it forward as a motion, because we have certain days when you can bring forward a motion. And we did that. And then I literally went and lobbied the minister and you know, and said, look, we're not going to beat up on you. We're not going to beat up on you in question period. We want to work with you on this language, and we want to get it through. And she was open to that, and we did that. We got the motion through, and finally a settlement has been provided. And that's, you know, it's just, I mean, for those people, it was very, very important in the total scale of thing. I mean, it was a justice that was done. But it's an evidence of how members of Parliament can work, even individually or with their colleagues within the system, and get something done. Just two more points I want to make. Lobbying. A lot of the work that I've done in Parliament and on the outside has been actually lobbying. I lobby myself, like other, like ministers, all the time. But what I learned in my experience as a member of Parliament is that most people have very little interaction with the political system, and they actually don't know how it works. And so over the years, I've done a lot of lobbying workshops for community organizations to basically talk about the process of how you lobby, and that it can be very, very successful. Because I think there's this myth that politics is static, especially if you're dealing with a conservative government, and it's immovable. That's not true. Politics is very dynamic. It's always changing. Public opinion does play a role. And so how you mobilize, again, you can do it on the streets, you can do it through petitions and all of that, but how you actually do lobbying and start influencing members of Parliament. So, for example, one of the groups that I did some work with was the Students for a Sensible Drug Policy. They came to Parliament Hill several years, and we would sort of do our little lobbying workshops, and then they would go speak to MPs, sometimes 50 MPs at a time. And they would talk about their own experience as students with drug policy and why criminalization of young people for drug use was just ridiculous, right? And it was coming from them. It wasn't me. It was their voice. And that was so important. It was a very pivotal thing, and something that I've learned, whether it was the voice of drug users or Vandu or students or sex workers or people who are homeless. When that gets carried forward and people learn how to do that work, because they do have to learn, and not to be intimidated by the political process, and that you can lobby members of Parliament, and you can actually develop that relationship, is something that I felt very good about doing. So finally, life after politics. People keep on saying to me, oh, congratulations on your retirement. And I keep saying, I didn't say I was retiring, I just said I wasn't running again. So life after politics, probably more politics, but in a different role. And I think the most important thing I want to do is, one of the most important things I want to do is to encourage young people to run. I had the wonderful experience of being with the caucus from 2011, with the NDP, and 60 members from Quebec, many of whom were under 30, and I feel still angry today when I remember how the media trashed these young folks. Like, how dare they get elected? They didn't campaign. They didn't do this. What do they know? Blah, 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 blah. And they got elected, and for many of them, it was like, you know, jump in at the deep end, and it was sink or swim. And the first challenge that they met was back-to-work legislation for the postal workers, where we had, I think it was 48 hours of nonstop debate in the House. And I watched these young people, some of whom were, the youngest was 19, our youngest MP, and he became the chair of the Ethics Committee. Like, this is an amazing young guy. The opposition always chairs the Ethics Committee in Parliament, and Thomas Mulcair knew this kid was bright, so he made him the chair of the Ethics Committee. And so he's, you know, he's got all these high-powered MPs on his committee or going at one another on, you know, all the scandal and the ethics. And here's this, I mean, he's now 23, but still very young. And so I watched that young caucus, you know, at 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock, and they were all on their computers in the lobby writing their, I mean, I never used a computer to write any speeches. And they were all doing their research and making their speeches about Canada Post and back to work legislation. And I thought, wow, this is going to be a really remarkable caucus. They're up for it. And so I've been very inspired by that caucus from 2011 as the official opposition. And so what I want to end by saying is that I really want us to move beyond cynicism. I want us to carry that message to people and forget about whatever the media says, and to focus on the fact that this is an historic election. And I'm not going to be partisan here. You have your own political opinions, I have mine. But I think we all know it is a very historic election in terms of the direction that this country has been going, and we have an opportunity to change that direction. And part of that is, to come back to my original message, is reaching out. And it's not a matter of forcing people to vote. I've learned that doesn't work. Voting is an outcome. Voting is only the outcome of people who feel a vested interest and a belief that their vote can count and mean something. So you have to actually go back. So, I mean, it's a bit late now because we're in the election, but nevertheless, it's still an important lesson. So I hope as I continue my political life in whatever way or another, that I will be able to continue to help do that, to move us beyond that cynicism and to empower the voice of people to be engaged in the political process in whatever way, by running, by being involved in a party, by being involved in an organization, whether it's international, national, local, or in your school, whatever it might be, and to have people understand that they can influence and change the outcome of what happens. And we have many lessons in history where that's happened. So I'm going to leave it there, and I thank you so much for coming, and I hope maybe my few experiences has helped us understand politics a little bit better. Thank you.
Thank you so very much. I know that for myself, what you said has made me feel hopeful. So thank you. We do have some time for questions, and there's a microphone that's in the aisle. Does it come off? So then, does it come off? Okay, then I guess people, okay. So people, if you want to ask a question, maybe I will go around with the mic. Libby, you can stay at this mic then. Okay. How does that sound?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just want Libby to mention the action she did with Janos Mote with Greenpeace.
Well, that was before I was an MP. I was a city councillor, and if you can believe it, I was training to swim in a swimming thing, like a contest. I was a good swimmer. I can still swim, but I'm not as good as I used to be. So I had a coach, and actually I think it was a bit competitive. Gordon Price was on council, and he had the same coach. I think I was a bit competitive and decided I had to beat him. And it was a triathlon, but I was just doing the swimming part. So I had this coach, and we used to practice out at Spanish Banks, like swimming in the ocean, right? And these big warships would come in. You know, it's when the Americans were sending in their warships. And I had been very involved in working in Vancouver for a nuclear weapons-free zone, which we did get. It was a whole civic movement around the world. And Vancouver was very much in the lead on that. And Ellen followed very strongly after that when she was on city council during the centennial and after. and so we saw these warships, and it was actually my coach who said, "Well, you know, what is that?" And I said, "Oh, it's a warship, and it's got nuclear weapons, and they're not meant to be here, and they won't disclose that they've got, you know, they have a policy of neither confirm nor deny, and blah, blah, blah." She goes, "We should swim around it." I was like, "Really?" "Yeah." She says, "I could get other swimmers in my club." So, okay. And this is another example of how I never really planned anything. It just sort of happened. And so before I knew it, we were out there with Greenpeace in a little dinghy, and they rowed us out, or I guess they had a motor. They motored us out to the warship, which is slap bang in the middle of Burrard Inlet. And there was about six of us, and we all jumped in the water. We had wetsuits on. It was pretty cold. It was August, but it was cold out there. And we swam around the warship in protest. And what I remember is that this warship is like, it's got to be like 10 stories high. And it has big kind of wings that come out, because that's where all the planes come in, right? So like, as you're sort of looking up, it's like a big ceiling above you, 10 stories high. And all the sailors were hurling insults at us. I mean, they were not happy that we were swimming around the warship. Of course, we got some media coverage, and it was, anyway, it was a fun thing to do.
Hi, Libby. The question I wanted to ask, my name is Shauna Sylvester, and I work at the Center for Dialogue. And I've watched you. I was there. I remember that day handing out signs on 12th Avenue with you, and the big dogs coming up to attack. And you know,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So I've watched you, and you were my MP for many years. The question I wanted to ask you, and I know it's a question a lot of people I know who have considered politics and some that are now, is that they think that they can achieve more by not going into politics. Uh-huh. And they look at the cost, particularly for women, and the cost, particularly for somebody on the West Coast. How many times were you on that plane on Sunday nights coming back?
Every week.
Thursday. Yeah, and I would see you on Parliament Hill coming down at almost midnight walking out of something. You were one of the hardest workers on Parliament Hill. So the cost, the personal cost, do you think when you look back that you have achieved as much or more in Parliament than you did as an activist?
Oh boy, that's tough. I mean, I don't know, because, you know, I have that experience of being an MP now, and I don't know what I might have done if I hadn't been there, right, and how that would have played out. I do feel good about the work that was done, though, because I was able to work with such amazing allies, right? And so I never thought twice about that. It was always a partnership. And I had my bit to play, right? I was never alone. I might have been alone sometimes in the caucus. I might have been alone sometimes in Parliament, but I was never alone on the issue. And so that always kept me moving. And I mean, it's not for everybody, that's for sure, Shauna. And I think it is difficult for women. And I think, you know, in the NDP, we talk about family life, family work balance. But the whip says, you got to be in Ottawa, you know. And we have many members who have really young kids. We've had members who have had babies in office now. And it's tough for them. So it's part of a bigger question, I think, about politics and the public's perception, right? It can be merciless out there. We're merciless on each other. And the media can be merciless. And so if you take time out to, you know, stay home a day and look after your kids or something, it's like, oh, you're not doing your job, right? So there's definitely very high standards, and so you have to decide. But I do think it's important that we encourage people. To me, it's been the most incredible experience of my life. Like, I wouldn't give a day away on it, you know? So, like any work, there are ups and downs. There are things that you don't enjoy so much. I'm sure all of you could speak to that in your own lives, right? But at the end of the day, you ask yourself, am I making a contribution? Is it something of value? Does it mean something to me as well as the people I work with? And I think if the answer is yes. I mean, I decided not to run because I actually couldn't face the thought of another election. I've run in 16 elections. And I just couldn't, I love being an MP, I love the, all of that, and I thought, I can't do another election. And thank you for reminding me about the pit bulls. The one thing I hated in every election campaign is the door knocking and you don't know what dog is gonna come. Like, I'm not very good with dogs and I'm a bit afraid of like vicious dogs. So we were together when we faced like four or five pit bulls in that backyard on 12th Avenue. I remember I was like frozen. You were the one who kind of bravely inched forward. As of course, the guys who were drinking said, oh, they're fine. They won't hurt you as they're circling around us. Do you remember? We're like, they did put the sign up. Oh, yeah, because we sweet-talked them into it. Oh, my God.
Thank you, Libby, for that wonderful and inspiring talk. I was especially pleased with your reference to Harry Rankin as the person who gave you the push into politics, because as a student at Carson Graham in grade 10, I got Rankin's Law out of the library.
And really?
It was very, you know, transformational for me, just reading about, you know, his work on the Downtown East Side. And so I suppose I'd like to ask a question in the spirit of Harry Rankin, who was an outspoken communist, as people know. And that has to do with...
Well, he actually never did disclose that, so... You can speculate, but he never
really?
He never did disclose that. Anyway.
Oh, okay, well. So, nonetheless, in that spirit, I think that we're in a situation today where you have Bernie Sanders in the United States giving Hillary a run for her money for the Democratic nomination. You have Kashama Sawant, who's running for re-election, city council in Seattle. And of course, the biggest news is you have Jeremy Corbyn, who's now leader of the Labour Party.
Yeah.
So there seems to be a kind of rethinking on the left, post-Occupy, and the discussion, really, of the conflict between the 99 and the 1%.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if the NDP isn't a little bit now sort of frightful of the language of socialism, and there's been a bit of a discussion about Mulcair's pledge to balance the books and so on, a kind of, you know, move to austerity at maybe not the right historical moment. So I'd just be interested to hear your thoughts on that.
Well, you're very diplomatic and very careful about what you're saying, and I'm going to be very careful too, because I'm not running, and we are in the middle of election campaign. So, you know, and I'm not the person there who's like engineering the platform and all the rest of it. I try to use what influence I have and talk to people and so on. And I think, you know, in terms of where the NDP is at overall. I mean, I'm very proud of many of the positions that we've taken, you know, and that Mr. Mulcair has taken against C-51 or the Unfair Elections Act or on Syria. And so I do think that the party, and, you know, this is the party that has stood up at times, you know, whether it was the War Measures Act or Grace MacInnis and Angus MacInnis on the Tommy Douglas, you know, the internment of Japanese Canadians, and I think that's the party that we're proud of. And so my response to you would be, I think it's really important that people stay engaged. If you're interested in the political spectrum and the NDP and what they do, I talk to lots of NDPers and they complain about this or that, and I say, you know, it's not them, it's us. It's a collective. Now, certainly there are people who have, you know, more power than the rank and file, but what happens at a convention? I mean, I've gotten things through at convention that I know the party brass weren't that happy about, right? But because we organized and got people on board, we got stuff through, and that was the voice of the people of the party. And so I do think, I think Tom Mulcair is obviously being very strategic about what he does. He makes his decisions, and I'm not going to second guess that, and I'm not going to criticize it, frankly. But I will say that it's very important that we engage with the party and we we bring forward the issues and the concerns where we think the NDP needs to be better, needs to be stronger, and needs to be taking a different direction. That's what we have to do, and I will, I hope, continue to play a role in that. Now, in an election, it's an election. But what happens afterwards is going to be very interesting. Of course, we don't know the outcome. But I mean, a whole other topic of discussion that maybe one day should happen, because we've had experience with this in BC, is what happens when social democratic governments do get elected. And what are the expectations from Labour or from different constituencies? And, you know, how people are, how do they work with that government? We actually don't know a lot about it. We've had some experience here in BC with NDP governments, and it's been, you know, there have been some good examples of how to work with a government, how you work with your allies. But there have also been some really, I think, you know, bad experiences for people. So I actually think we have a lot to learn about that, about how we work with a government that is progressive, and we, you know, our demands are higher or stronger than what the government feels that they can deliver. How do you negotiate that? How do you work that out? It's a very important political question that we don't pay a lot of attention to. So that may become a big question after the election.
Thank you, Libby. Stephanie Langford. So this is a perfect question, and I did write this question before I just heard the last speaker. I am aware, Libby, of your socialist roots. We do see the rise of socialist ideas and concepts in broader social movements, exemplified by Shama Sawant in Seattle, by Bernie Sanders and Jeremy Corbyn in the UK. I represent Socialist Alternative. Here's our election magazine here. And it is a national organization looking to bring socialist ideals and principles into brighter light, which I know the NDP historically has embraced. So what drives my activism, and something that you've talked about tonight, is stories of people who talk about what it's like to live on minimum wage of $11.25, or being at round tables with on austerity. And so my question is, now that you've formally left the NDP, are you considering returning to your socialist roots? And would you consider helping to build a socialist movement in Canada?
Well, I mean, I don't think I ever left them. And, you know, but I also don't want to be in a box. I, you know, most people are not in a political ideological box. I work on issues. And, you know, whatever reputation I have is what people decide to give me or not. I don't worry about that. What I worry about, not worry, but what I try to use my energy to work on are things that I care passionately about. So I don't really care about the labels or the boxes or how you might characterize it. If you want to characterize it like that, it's fine. So I can only tell you that, and I'm sure that, I'm going to take a little rest because I am tired, but I'm sure I'll, you know, kind of reinvent myself in some way or another, and I'll continue to be politically active, and I'll work on the issues that I really care about and that I think need to be worked on, and, you know, to speak out. So that's all I can say, you know.
Thank you for this amazing lecture. For someone who said, well, you said you don't know how to, you're not a lecturer, but you did a fantastic job. Thank you for that.
Oh, thank you.
I'm going to have two questions, I guess. So thanks to Mr. Harper, the entire political landscape in Canada has shifted to right. Mm-hmm. So NDP used to be left, not anymore. It's considered, I think, center-left, maybe. Liberals are considered kind of right, and obviously the conservatives are far right. Someone such as myself, an average person, is there any way, I mean, considering the fact that we don't really have any left-leaning parties in Canada right now, is there anything that we can do as the constituency to kind of change that, or do you think it's something that's even important to have in a country. My second question is, I'm gonna quickly ask that actually. I come from a country where people actually die to have the chance to vote. And when I talk to people here and see them, they don't care about the, you know, the politics, they don't even care about the fact that their vote is really important. When I post something on social media or talk to my friends, they're like, why do you post so much? Why do you talk about this stuff? What do you think? I can tell them, like, what is it that I can tell them to convince them to care about the future of their country and their children? I mean, what is it that I can tell them to have, I don't know, for them to be more engaged in what's happening in Canada? Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you for the questions. And in terms of the first question, I mean, it's difficult for me to answer because I don't know, you know, what part of Vancouver you're in or who your candidates are. But I mean, if the candidates that are presenting themselves to you from whatever party are not, if they don't satisfy what you believe should be done, then the most important thing for you is to find a way to engage that, right? Not in a hostile way. And again, an election is really kind of the outcome of everything. But it nevertheless, and particularly when it's a long campaign, I do think Mr. Harper made a big mistake thinking that this long campaign was going to be to his benefit. I think it's actually the complete opposite. And he's right, quite in a muddle right now. And it is providing more opportunity for debate and changes to take place. So, you know, it's not like the parties are like static and out there, right? They're influenced by what goes on. And it's up to us to try and find the pressures and the way we can bring that influence. And so you can choose to do that in many different ways. You can choose to and get involved in a local campaign, get to know the candidate, find out where they stand, ask them what they're willing to raise if they do get elected within their own caucus. You know, it's again, it's not a black and white or a static thing, right? So there are many ways to find that engagement, both during and after the election. In terms of telling people to vote, I totally understand your frustration. When I used to go mainstreeting a lot, I would sometimes feel infuriated and even angry when I would have some young people, not everybody, throw leaflets back at me and say, oh, you're all the same, like, get lost. Like, and I used to think, wow, this is incredible. And I was trying to get at that about the cynicism. Like, in East Vancouver, there were elections where Aboriginal people in particular were left off the voters list, and they would go to polling stations and line up only to be told to go away, and they were in the wrong poll. And they would go to another poll, and then they'd be told the same thing, and they would still stay in a lineup. And I was very inspired by that people were motivated to vote, and I would feel very angry at privileged young people who were well-educated, who didn't understand, right? I couldn't get it. I still don't get it, actually. But the only thing I can say to you is what I said before, and that is that voting is the outcome of something else that happened. So not voting is an outcome of being cynical and feeling completely disconnected, whether you're educated or not. Voting is an outcome of feeling like it is one tool, only one, pretty simple tool for doing something. So really in politics, what we have to do, we have to get beyond the voting day. We have to back it up. You have to go back to where people are, to find out why they feel cynical, to find out how you engage them. As you say, there are many places in the world where people have died for the right to vote. Aboriginal people in this country only got the right to vote in the 1960s, right? So these are things that were fought hard for, and yet we just throw it away. So I totally know where you're coming from, but we have to go back and find out what causes those folks to be where they are, and to find that point of engagement. bring people to their own conclusion. You can't force people to vote. You know, they have mandatory voting in Australia, and I don't know whether it works or not, but I mean, I'm not particularly a fan of that idea. I think it's more about political engagement, right? And when people feel they have a vested interest in doing something, voting will happen.
Hi, Libby. Thank you for your lecture. That was very inspiring. I am a relatively young person, and amongst young people, I find that there's a sense of insecurity if one wants to get into politics. And you kind of consider yourself having to be insanely brilliant, having to have started young, have a really impressive resume, you know, all that stuff. And what would you say to someone like me who started a little bit later and doesn't really have all of the experience that one thinks one might need to, you know, run for city council or run as an MP or what have you, but wants to make a change?
Well, I'm really glad you raised it because I meant to say something about it and I didn't. And that's this whole confidence question. I don't know how people see me, you know, whatever way, but I can tell you sometimes I have been terrified of what I'm doing, like speaking, like feeling a lack of confidence or doubt. And it's weird that it's expected that if you're in politics, that you, A, you know everything, B, you're an accomplished speaker, whatever, you know, and I'm just an ordinary person, right? I have certain experiences. There are certain things that push me to do things. But, you know, I can't say I'm a person who has total confidence in what I'm doing. There are times I doubt what I say or do. And I that may be particularly true for women. It's still a very sexist environment for women in politics. There are double standards. I mean, I could go on about this for hours, I actually went to a conference once where it was women lawyers, so they were like very well-educated professional women, and it was a panel of women politicians from every party, and we all had to speak about our experience in politics, so we all did that. And the first woman who got up in the audience, she said, well, thank you so much. That was so interesting. And now I know why I never want to run. I was like, oh my God, this is the exact opposite of what we were meant to be leaving somebody with. So I don't want to leave with a negative feeling. Like, there are challenges, and I think there are challenges for women in particular. I'm very proud of the NDP for its affirmative action policies of seeking out underrepresented candidates, for example. 44% of our candidates are women. We have 22 Aboriginal candidates running in this election. We have at least 10 LGBT candidates. We have many candidates of color. So I'm very proud of the diversity that the NDP is putting forward. And I wish I could introduce you to some of the young folks in our caucus. I mean, wow, what they went through. And they got trashed by the media, and they rose above it. And so I can only say is that, you know, like, even though we might all have issues around confidence, I do, and I've been an MP for 18 years, okay? So I'm sort of disclosing that, you know, that I still like, oh my God, can I do this, you know? I think the important thing is building support around you and having friends and allies. And if you're interested in politics, is finding out where you can get involved and learning. Because the parliament actually must represent the diverse. It doesn't represent the face of Canada, right? It's slowly moving there. But when I got elected, it was mostly older, gray-haired men in suits, right? When I first got involved municipally, there were hardly any women in politics. It was incredible. I mean, Grace MacInnis was the first woman elected from BC in, what was it, 1965. It's not that long ago. So there's still a lot of barriers, but there's also a lot of inspiration. So sometimes you got to take the plunge, and there are good There used to be the BC Women's Campaign School here that was a great learning center for women who wanted to run. I can't remember if it still operates. But, you know, come and talk to some of us who have run. So I want to encourage you. I want to tell you it's been an amazing experience. Even though there are challenges, it's an amazing experience to be an elected representative. So think about it.
You know, listening to your talk, I had a really strong regret that I didn't live where I could have voted for you. And I've been around here a long time, and I remember Harry Rankin, and I remember when Harry Rankin was asked to come up to Simon Fraser during the student anti-bureaucratic movement, anti-corporate university movement, and Harry kind of distance himself from that because the generational question was so much on the it was not really a political question.
Uh-huh.
The cultural politics were not.
When was that?
Well, that would have been 1968, 1969, 70.
Yeah.
Although I must say, in regard to Harry Rankin, I lived down at that time. I lived down near Nanaimo and McGill,
yeah.
And there was a a very dangerous crossing there for children, and my children were going to go across the street to their little school. And we were really scared because of the traffic, right? And I've never done this before, but I called up Harry Rankin and I said, you know, this is a pretty bad place, right? And within about a week, there was a traffic light there. But my point, what comes across, and I just wanted to say this from, you know, from a political perspective, what comes across what you in your experiences here, I wish more people could understand the ethics of politics and the politics of ethics, right? And that what comes across sitting here listening to you is a sense of authenticity about your experience. And I don't know how one conveys that, you know, really, to the cynical or the pessimistic or the helpless, you know, the sense that you can keep voting somewhere in our where we live and always lose, right? Because you're not, it's the first past the post and
yep.
It's all that. So I guess my question is really part observation, part experience, but in terms of the broadband initiatives and all, you know, to make sure that the kind of position that you stand for, the ethics, what I call the ethics of authenticity, that people can feel that they're not disenfranchised when they continue to lose the election, when we know that this particular government does not represent the Canadian people. I mean, it has institutionalized itself as a minority government, right? And now we're looking at the NDP and the Liberals who loathe the idea of alliances, right? And negotiating for something that is not just the standard political measure of winning the election. It's just an observation. Maybe you have something you could.
Well, thank you for your very thoughtful comments. I feel like you've kind of hit the conundrum on the head. And, you know, it's sort of a circle, right? That if people are cynical, it's hard to engage them, and if you don't engage them, they continue to be cynical and they don't vote, and on it goes. I mean, if everybody who was in a union, for example, voted in a progressive way, we probably wouldn't have Stephen Harper. I mean, Harper got elected with, what was it, 39% of the vote or something, but the voter turnout was also very low. So, I mean, these are all big political questions, and that's why, I mean, a federal election is super important, obviously, but it, to me, it's all the stuff that feeds into it about politics that's really important, the organizing, the mobilizing, how we engage young people. And I do think that we would fare a lot better if we didn't have first past the post. And I'm very proud that the NDP is very committed to proportional representation, and certainly it's worked a lot better in Europe because I feel like people would know that their vote counted a lot better. It actually would count. So that's something that we've got to hang on to and make sure, you know, depending on what the outcome of the election is that we make progress. But and in terms of coalitions, like I would not dismiss that. I mean, we have very little experience in Canada with coalitions. In Europe, it's much more common and understood. And I think in Canada, the idea that you have a coalition before the election, I don't think is going to happen. I mean, it's obviously not happening. Each party has a right to run, and each party has a right to field their candidates, and you make up your mind. But after an election, where you can sort of size up what's happened, and we saw that in 2008 election, right? Where, I mean, it was Jack Layton who kind of put the wheels in motion for an arrangement to defeat Mr. Harper based on parliamentary procedure. And of course, he then pulled the plug on Parliament and prorogued the House, and then unfortunately the Liberals bailed on the agreement later on, Mr. Ignatieff. But I think it was very important because it got people talking about it, right? This, like, what... in fact, there's a very good article by Carl Nuremberg in rabble.ca just about a week or so ago, and he's a retired CBC reporter from Montreal for decades, and he wrote this fantastic article about Harper's position on, you know, how many votes he has and what he intends to do and what parliamentary procedure is, and it's very informative, so you might want to go look for it. It was about a week ago, and because this may all well play out after October 19th, this is going to be an incredible election. Like, it is a squeaker. It's going to come down to riding by riding, I think. And we don't know what the outcome is going to be. So the possibilities of some kind of a electoral arrangement after the election, Mr. Trudeau has been quite negative about that. Mr. Mulcair has been making comments that, you know, there are possibilities depending on what happens. So after the election, it could be a whole different sort of scenario that unfolds. And I think when that happens, we will need people to be out there quickly responding in a positive way. When it happened the last time, Harper, who you should never underestimate, he got out there really fast on all the radio stations, and I remember, you know, he characterized it as sort of a parliamentary coup, right? So he immediately characterized it as an undemocratic procedure, and we were like, we just weren't quick enough, right? I mean, I remember there were big rallies in Vancouver supporting the idea of this arrangement, but they got out. So if whatever happens after the election, I think we have to be ready. If there are opportunities and there are, I'm not going to speculate. Okay, it's not my role to do that right now. But if something like that happens, we better be ready to be there to be, you know, to support. If there's some progressive initiative underway that we think is important in terms of the upholding the public interest. Sorry, that's a very meandering, vague way. I'm just being very careful about what I say because I'm not running. I'm not an official spokesperson for the NDP. I offer you some comments and ideas. That's it.
Do you have energy for one or two more?
Sure.
Okay, one or two more questions?
Hi, thanks again for coming and speaking with us tonight. And I really liked the story you gave about going out to the American warship, you and your friends. That was a new story for me. I never knew you did that. And it sort of, to me, goes with a lot of stuff we've been seeing recently, especially in this part of the world, whether you look at what happened in Seattle when they were trying to block the icebreaker that's going up to help the shell rig in the Arctic, or before that with the people trying to block the actual rig in Seattle, or here at Kinder Morgan's stuff up in Burnaby where I was arrested and in Estoten, so on and so forth. Do you see this as necessarily increasing this sort of direct action, and could it be a way of increasing young people's political engagement if they were to see more people do that and more people in positions of power go out there and put their own bodies on the line and risk arrest and so forth?
Yeah. Thank you for raising that. I do think political activism is increasing. It's incredible. And I think there's a very important role for political activism and some of these direct actions in our country and internationally, right? And as I believe firmly that, you know, it's not either or. It's all these multiple levels that have to work together, right? Where it's particular actions, where it's demonstrations on the street, whether it's lobbying, whether it's the letter writing, going to meet your MP, you're speaking before a committee. It's like all of this stuff. It's like change is, it's a scientific principle. It's like a kettle boiling, right? Eventually when a kettle boils, the water turns to steam, right? There's a qualitative change. It's the same in politics, right? You get to a certain point and there's a qualitative change that takes place based on everything that you're doing. So I see that as very encouraging. I think the issue and what has always interested me is how you then take that activism and that connection and you relate it back to the electoral system. And it doesn't mean that you have to like drop everything you're doing and say, well, you know, I just got to be a good soldier in X or Y party. But it does mean that social movements and political activists have to engage with the political process. We can't leave it out of the equation. If we do, we're just leaving it to Harper. Now, we've got more particular challenges because of Bill C-51. And as you know, I don't have the material in front of me, but one of the real concerns about Bill C-51 is what they, you know, deem to be sort of suspicious activities. And, you know, particularly, I think, as it relates to Aboriginal activism, but also environmental. And as we heard earlier, you know, the Canada Revenue Agency has been set on all kinds of groups, and there's all kinds of organizations now that are very worried about their charitable status or their status generally. So this is a deliberate political work that's being done, right? We've had the most right-wing government we've had in the history of Canada. It's a very ideological, systematic attack on people's rights and the suppression of people's rights in this country that I think surprises us. We have an opportunity to change that. So don't stop the political activism. Be smart about it. I mean, somebody asked me the other day at a little Shaw TV interview, they said, well, what are the two most important things? Actually, it was Wendy Pedersen, who Anne will know from the Downtown East Side, and she said, what are the two things that you've learned? And I said, one is you always have to find unity. Like, God help us, the times we fight and we divide ourselves because of, you know, this or that or whatever. Find the unity. And secondly, I said to her, look for unusual allies. Look for what's not expected in your allies and build bridges with those people. Because that's how you can transform what's taking place. So keep up with the activism, but also figure out how to engage with the political process, and don't think it's something away from you or foreign to you, because you have to influence that too.
I think that's a really good way to actually end your evening with us. So thank you for all of you for coming out and engaging with Libby. And Libby, thank you for engaging with us. And we're honored by your accepting of the Grace MacInnis Award.
Well, thank you very much for coming, everybody. And thank you for the questions and comments.